Coming up, I'll walk you through everything you need to know about optimizing your Windows Virtual Desktop deployment. And this is the third how-to in a series for preparing, deploying, and optimizing Windows Virtual Desktop. Now, by now, you should already have your Windows Virtual Desktop tenant, as well as your first host pool running. And if you haven't already, please check out aka.ms/WVD playlist to get caught up. Now, at the heart of optimization is performance, and here we focused on user experience and storage, as well as scaling. Now, starting with the user experience and storage innovation, FSLogic's profiles allow you to separate user profiles from the Windows virtual machine and persist these profiles as user-assigned virtual disks in Azure Storage, and then dynamically attach them each time a user brokers a host session. Now, this approach has many advantages for user experience compared to classic roaming user profiles. Primarily, it also enables a seamless roaming experience for apps that rely on local app data locations, like Outlook and OneDrive, as you can see here in the Microsoft directory. Now, this also allows you to use cache mailboxes for local-like access to email and OneDrive files on demand. Now, I'm going to show you the steps to get this all configured for our users. And remember that you'll need your Windows Virtual Desktop tenant running along with your host pool before we can get started. Now, first, we're going to create a storage account, and that will store our user-assigned VHD files that we're going to use with FSLogic's profiles. Now, to do that, we're going to go into our Azure portal and create our storage account, and I'll click the Add button. Now, from there, I can basically define exactly where this storage account is going to be created in terms of which resource group that we want to add to it. So I'll select my WVD resource group, and I'm going to give it a name, AF Store WVD. In my case, and then we can select the performance tier, the location, and also the account type. Now I'm going to go ahead and click advance, and for the most part I'll keep all the defaults here, but you can see things like virtual network settings, if we want to turn on data protection, etc., or if we want to tag that account as well. Now here I'm going to go ahead and click create, and now we have a landing zone effectively for our virtual disk to be stored into within Azure Storage. Now, our next step that we have to do is actually to go in and make sure that we have Azure Active Directory authentication enabled for Azure files. Our next step then is to create a custom role that we're going to use as part of reading and writing into Azure files. Now, here you can see that I've got a JSON file configured. Main things you can do, and you can actually copy this file for yourselves, the name needs to be unique to your environment, and also the subscription ID needs to be your subscription ID, and we've covered this in previous demo benches for WVD. Now, within PowerShell, a couple things that we need to do here is install and import the modules for Azure Storage and also for Azure Resources. Then we can call that JSON file that we just saw as an input file using the new -az role definition commandlet. And we're going to go ahead and call our input file that we just edited, and then we're going to create our role. So now once we have our role created, we can move on and actually create a file share. So the way to do that is to go into our storage account. We're going to scroll down into files. And within files, we have to create a file share. And this is going to serve as the location where we're going to store our user virtual disks. So we're going to give it a name. We're going to assign a storage quota. Here I'm going to assign a smaller storage quota, but this can be the size that you need for all your users that you'll be logging in with. And I'm going to have my file share already set up, and now it's ready to start receiving user virtual disks. So now within PowerShell, what I need to do is actually define and give permissions to a user to be part of that role assignment that we just created. So from within our PowerShell, we're going to go ahead and call our get Azure role definition commandlet for the new role that we just created. We're going to give it a scope. Now, importantly here, you're going to have to substitute the subscription ID, the resource group, and the storage account, as well as the file share that we just saw. Then we'll run that. Then we'll run our last commandlet, which is the new AZ role assignment with our username, and that can be multiple users or a group, and also apply them to the role definition name that we just created and assign the scope that we see up above in line 2. Okay, so now we've got basically our users set up with the right roles inside of Azure and to be able to read and write. Now we have to set up a few things in the virtual machine itself for FSLogic. Now importantly, if you're using a gallery image for Windows Virtual Desktop, the FSLogic software is already installed. If you're not, you have to install FSLogic software in that image. Now a couple of settings that you have to set in the registry are, first, you'll create a key called profiles in HKLM software FSLogic. Then we're going to create two different settings, a D word enabled to one, and also a multi-string with our SMB path to our file share that we have inside of Azure Storage, that user files directory that you saw me create earlier. So now we have to do a one-time setting to actually grant permissions for the users and also map a directory on the local virtual machines. Now here we're going to use netuse, and we're actually going to map the Z drive. We're going to use a key that I'll show you how to get to in a second that's found in Azure Storage. And then after that, we get that key imported in, we're going to have to assign, in this case, Megan's credentials to be able to have the right accolade to be able to write to that location. So I'm going to go ahead and run the first command, and that's going to set up the Z drive with the right permissions and the right key. And now I'm going to give Megan the right access to be able to write into that location. And once I do that, now Megan is set up not only for this virtual machine, but she'll be set up for subsequent VMs as well. So here's where I found that SMB path, and you'll see that I had to convert it from HTTPS to SMB path string. And our key was located in the access keys under settings for that storage account that we saw earlier in the first command line. All right, so now once all of that is set up, now we can go in and see that our user files at this point will be empty. So we don't have anything stored in there because a user hasn't signed in yet. So what I need to do now is actually go back into the VM, and I'm going to log out of this session. Right now I'm logged in as Megan. And what I'm going to have to do here is make sure that the virtual machine that I log in with after this is a virtual machine that Megan hasn't yet signed into. Because if a profile is already there, the FSLogix profile won't be able to create and work as designed. So in my case, what I've done is actually removed Megan's profile from that virtual machine so I can log in with her account as if it was the first time, but you could log into a separate VM as well. So I'll go ahead and test this now by going into aka.ms/wvdweb. And now that's going to give us access to the app group that we created in a previous demo for WVD, and we'll see all the different apps that we have access to. And I'm going to go ahead and click on Word here, and what that's going to do is launch the remote desktop session for just the remote app of Word. And what this is doing in the background, once I sign in, is it's actually going to create that virtual disk assigned to the user of Megan so that in any subsequent sessions or logins that she makes, we'll be able to continue to use that virtual disk across different session hosts. So this first login will take a little bit more time than your typical login, but now I've built that first virtual disk for Megan. So to check that this is being done, I'm going to go back into the storage accounts in Azure. We'll go back into our file share, and we're going to see that the Megan directory has actually been created right here, and we'll click on that, and you'll actually see the virtual disk itself has been generated for Megan to log in with in subsequent sessions for Windows. Now, what this is going to do is it's going to actually feel like local storage then for any different session that gets brokered to Megan for any virtual machine that she logs into with the future. So that was our FSLogix profile, but let's move on to configuring OneDrive. So we can leverage Office and OneDrive settings to direct files to Office 365 storage locations. Now the nice thing here is that you get effectively things like files on demand as part of the configuration for OneDrive. And you can also go in and you can get a terabyte by default for users to be able to access. So you're not paying twice for storage. And that way a lot of those files are actually stored in OneDrive as opposed to that storage quota that we saw earlier. And here we can back up our desktop pictures and documents directories directly from the VM and also access those from other machines that user might be using. Now the nice thing is here I can use several different group policy settings to configure the experience. This is going to work on Office 365 Pro Plus as well as Office 2019 volume licensing editions. Now within group policy, to get to some of the standard settings, first for storage, you're going to want to go to the locations for each of the apps, and actually in Excel in this case, Excel options, then save. I can set default file locations if I want to, and these are pretty common settings for remote desktop services environments. And I'll configure those as needed for any of the apps that I want to configure with different default save locations. So beyond the Office app default file save locations and OneDrive settings, you can do a couple of things, and I'll just point those out in group policy as well. So the first thing that we might want to configure is silently signing users into OneDrive sync client with their Windows credentials. These have to match the logins that they have is with their UPNs that they're using for Office 365. We can enable that. We can also do a few other things in OneDrive to make the transition very seamless and take advantage of that OneDrive storage. We can also silently move Windows known folders to OneDrive. This is useful if they've already got machines that they're using that you want to move into those remote desktop services or WVD environments. And also use OneDrive files on demand, so you don't have to store all of the local files. You can just store the files on demand files there that users can see what they have, but not necessarily load them into their roaming storage. And also set the maximum size of the files that get stored into that virtual disk so that you can limit that using this group policy setting. With OneDrive services, part of Microsoft's cloud infrastructure, users can also access files kept in OneDrive. And because of the proximity between virtual machines that are in WVD and OneDrive services themselves, even large files hydrate very quickly. But now let's talk about how you can make your transition from on-premises RDS environments and file shares more seamless moving into WVD. Now, if your current remote desktop architecture uses file shares to access shared locations on-prem, you can use Azure File Sync to synchronize on-premises file server content to Azure Storage and enable seamless access for both files that initially were generated in Azure or on-prem, so they can be accessed by WVD session hosts from a nearby location. Now, this is also powerful if you're already using FS Logix in your on-prem implementation of RDS, since you can use Azure File Sync to replicate and migrate your profiles into Azure Storage. For complete details on how to get this configured, check out aka.ms/AzureFileSync. Now, the last thing I'll touch on with optimization is automated scaling with WVD. Now, a primary benefit of hosting your remote desktop service in the cloud is that you can shut down compute resources and save costs during off-peak hours, then restart them on a schedule. In this case, we set up logic to determine activity levels in VMs before draining VMs of user sessions and then shutting them down. Now, also in case we need to start another VM as user densities exceed predefined thresholds that we've set up, we can do that as well with these scripts. Now, the scaling scripts are available for download on GitHub at aka.ms/wvdscaling, and these run in the context currently of a connected VM. And we'll continue streamlining how we scale in the coming weeks using Azure Automation. So that was a quick overview of a few options to optimize the performance of your Windows Virtual Desktop environments to improve user experiences and storage, as well as scaling automation. Now, we're not done yet. In the coming weeks, we're going to also share updates and optimizations for managing apps in Windows Virtual Desktop and WVD admin portal updates as well. Be sure to subscribe to Microsoft Mechanics for those and other updates that are coming soon. And thanks for watching.